Hi, and welcome to this session called Porting Your PC Game to Microsoft Game Development Kit and Xbox Services. My name is Alexander Botcher, and I'm a technical director at Xbox Game Studios Publishing. Let's start with a brief agenda about this presentation. First, I'll do an introduction. I'll talk briefly about the partner dashboard, Xbox service sandboxes, runtime initialization, Xbox user management, cloud saves, also known as connected storage, rich presence, achievements, and gamer score, throttling and API call limitations, and the certification process. This talk focuses on the implementation differences between Steam and Game Pass titles on PC. A Game Pass title means publishing your title in the Windows Store and leveraging Xbox services. For lots of technical details, examples, and API references, please visit the link below. First off, the Microsoft Partner Center dashboard. It's similar to the Steamworks Partner Dashboard, where you set up configuration options for your title. This is where you will manage store listing information, Xbox service configurations like achievements, rich presence, and matchmaking rules, builds and flights, also known as Steam branches and depots. The dashboard website allows you to upload a full package build and publish them to either a sandbox or flight. As of September last year, there's now a scriptable method of uploading new builds and publishing them to the store. It's a cross-platform and open-source utility that can be used for both PC and Xbox packages. Please check out the package uploader in the link below. What's a sandbox? The Xbox service sandboxes is a segregated instance of the Xbox services that has limited access. Only accounts that have been created for the sandboxes has access to them. This reduces the risk of leaks and accidental updates of production configuration. The computer has to be set up to talk to the sandbox endpoint. Setting the sandbox will affect the Windows Store and gaming runtime. The gaming runtime has to be restarted to change the setting, but you don't need to restart your computer. You can use either the device portal or a command line tool to query and set the sandbox. The link for the command line tool is provided below. Initializing. Since Game Pass titles are simple Win32 application, initializing isn't more complicated than calling XGame runtime initialize to initialize the GDK specific layer. The additional library will just give you access to unique functionality. XGame runtime initialize will only fail if the game runtime is not initialized or if it's not running properly. The gaming runtime will be installed, if not installed already, when the game is installed or when you install the SDK. Once you've done that, initialize the Xbox Service SDK extension library by calling XBL initialize. XBL initialize uses the information provided in the Microsoft game config file that should be part of your project. With the latest GDK, most of the functionality of Steam API init will be handled by the bootstrapper. This includes the entitlement check, checking if the user owns the title, checking for and applying updates. And this applies to both required and not required downloads, and limiting the game to a single concurrent process. But first, let's talk about async methods. Several API functions have the async postfix. This means that the operation performed by the function will take a non-trivial amount of time to complete. These functions use an application-managed object called async block. The async block has a callback method, but you can also use the async get status to poll or wait for the result. While the async library provides a default task management implementation using thread pools, you can override that implementation using the xAsync provider to tie in with your own system. Examples provided in the link below, and you can read all about the library functionality in the second link in this slide. All right, user management, signing in. Compared to Steam, there's no assumed user when first starting the game. You have some flexibility when to request the user handle, but you'll have to make sure at least one call to retrieve it. First, try a silent login. This will use the current Xbox profile that signed in. This will be the user that is used in the game bar and or the Xbox app. If that fails, call the normal login flow that will present the user with a login screen. The user will be able to select an existing account, log into a new one, or create one from scratch. I provided a simple example on how the login process could work. I create an async block object. I call xUserAddAsync with the silent flag. If it fails at this point, you're not going to get a user login. In the callback, we'll get the result using xUserAddResult. There's a special error return code called eGameUserNoDefaultUser. You'll get this during silent login if there's no default user. At this point, you can reuse the xAsync block object and just simply call xUserAddAsync with none. I'll note that successfully logging in doesn't mean that you're online. The credentials could be cached. In Steam, when the user signs out, it will take the game processes with it. The user can also sign it out the Xbox user either through the game bar or the Xbox app. In order for us to get a notification when this happens, we'll use XUser register for change event and check for the XUser change event signing out event type. At this point, we can choose how to handle that. You could either shut down or simply bring the game, continue the game warning the user or taking the user out of the gaming experience. Simplified user model is a way of handling a sign out the same way that Steam does. Setting this option will cause the game to shut down as soon as the user is signed out. Just disable the advanced user model in the Microsoft game config file as shown in the slide. Onto Cloud 6. Just like Steam, the GDK has multiple options on how to deal with cloud saves. Steam has auto cloud saves in addition to an explicit API. The GDK offers a no-code, simple, and advanced cloud saves. The no-code solution just requires to add a few entries in the Microsoft game config file. It doesn't even require you to link or use the GDK. Here's an example of adding the entry to the Microsoft game config file. Under save game storage, there's a no-code PC root, and you can set it relative to one of those options. You set up your service ID and the quota that you're using. It's a limit between 256 and 4096 megabytes, and the default is 256 unless your developer account manager has approved more. XGameSave Files is the simplest API and basically only requires one call. XGameSave Files, get folder with UI async. This will provide you with a path in the callback where you can read and write any settings or save games. The files won't change while the game is running. Instead, it will be synchronized at initialization or when the game has shut down. Third option is XGameSave. And this is also known as connected storage and is an explicit API with specific read and write methods for this system. It's implemented using a blob storage that synchronizes at earliest convenience, which means even when the game is running. It was designed to support console players that at any point could turn off their device and still expect their data to be synced. Here's a comparison table between XGameSave files versus XGameSave. The XGameSave file supports regular Win32 I/O operations, including the C runtime ones. The XGameSave one does not. It has an explicit API. The XGameSave API also allows for batch updates, and they're updated while the game is running. And we can request these to be flushed to the cloud at any point. The only difference that you'll see here is in the total file size limit, which is for XGameSave file 64 megabytes, and for XGameSave 16 megs. And it is technically the blob size limitation. The XGameSave is more robust and has the highest chance of uploading saves if the user quickly shuts down. Finally, to the quotas and file limits of the cloud saves. Since there's a limitation, you can also keep track of how much of the total size the user has used. Use XGameSave files get remaining quota or XGameSave get remaining quota, depending on what API you decide to use. All right, on to rich presence. The Xbox service and Steam Rich Presence are fairly similar in terms of user experience. With Steam, you can set multiple states per user, but with Xbox services, you can only set the user-facing status, which is displayed in the friends list. Xbox services allow you to subscribe to your friend's status changes in addition to your friend's device presence, like if they're online or not. Updating your Rich Presence only requires a single function call. It's called XBL presence set presence async, and it applies for both one-offs and progression achievements. In the picture, you see the partner dashboard. It shows the rich presence tab under the gameplay settings. I've added two entries, one for the main menu and one for our single player experience. In the sample to the right, I filled in the service config ID and the ID of the rich presence I want to use. I don't use tokens in this example, but it can be used to reuse rich presence strings where, for example, the game mode or level is referenced. And finally, achievements. The Xbox has two types of achievements. The most common one, which are required, are those that unlock a gamer score. The other type unlocks profile arc or in-game perks. The title must ship with at least 10 achievements that add up to a total 1,000 gamer score. Xbox services moved away from stat-based achievements, although self-supported, so if you're using Steam stats, you'll have to track them yourself. You can either store stats as part of the user profile data and synchronize it across devices with cloud saves, or use an online solution as the ones provided by PlayFab. To update an achievement, regardless if it's a one-off or progress, just use XBL achievements update achievements async. Here's an example of setting up and using an achievement. In the picture, you can see the partner dashboard. It shows the achievement tab under the gameplay settings. I've added an achievement that doesn't grant any gamer score and named it 1234567891. In the example, I referenced the achievement ID and set the progress to 100. 100 will instantly unlock the achievement. You'll notice that I checked for a specific error in the callback. You'll get this if you set the progress to the previous value. Avoid this by tracking the progress in the game. I'll tell you why in the next slide. Rate limitations. Most Xbox service function calls are backed by service REST calls. To avoid strain on the service, there are limitations on how often they can be called. There are both burst and sustained limits, in other words, short-term and long-term limits. The service will warn you if it has started throttling the responses to your requests if you exceed any of these by returning a HTTP E status 429, too many requests. The limits are different for different APIs, though. For a comprehensive list, please do check the link below. Here's some ideas on how to avoid the rate limitations. Only update rich presents when user moves between the main menu and in-game states. Only update achievements when the whole number changes. Progress is set with an integer between 0 and 100. Don't poll for information like friends list or present status. Use notification callbacks and poll at a lower frequency, like every 5 minutes. If you exceed the rate limitations during certifications, you might get rejected. If you get rejected, you'll have to redo the certification process again. More on that in the last section. Certification. Xbox service integration requires the title to go through manual certification. In general, it means that the game meets the bar for user experiences related to those services. A few categories that will be tested are correct name and terminology use, correctly displaying gamer tags. Modern gamer tags require a bit more work than the original one, for example. Handling loss of connectivity to services and staying within the rate limitations, like I mentioned before. Making sure that user privacy and privileges are respected. And if applicable, the multiplayer requirements are met in terms of invites, joinability, and communication, like party chat. You can send in your game for a pre-cert test before the game is finished. Just make sure you're confident about meeting all the requirements. This will give you a full report on which requirements are met and which ones aren't and why not. I'll also note that every update to the executable is also required to go through the process. If you're just updating content though, you don't need to go through the certification process. There's a full list of requirements and common failures to the certification process in the link below. And that concludes it. Thank you very much for listening and welcome to the Microsoft ecosystem.